Ako.
Ako.
Si Ferdinand Romualdez Marcos Jr.
Si Ferdinand Romualdez Marcos Jr.
Ay mataimtim na nanunumpa.
Ay taimtim na nanunumpa.
Natutuparin ko ng buong katapatan at sigasig.
Natutuparin ko ng buong katapatan at sigasig.
Ang aking mga tungkulin.
Ang aking mga tungkulin.
Bilang Pangulo ng Pilipinas.
Bilang Pangulo ng Pilipinas.
Pangangalagaan.
Pangangalagaan.
At ipagtatanggol.
At ipagtatanggol.
Ang kanyang konstitusyon.
Ang kanyang konstitusyon.
Ipatutupad ang mga batas nito.
Ipapatupad ang mga batas nito.
Magiging makatarungan sa bawat tao.
Magiging makatarungan sa bansa.
Kasihanawa ako ng Diyos.
Kasihanawa ako ng Diyos.
Congratulations, Mr. President.
Maraming salamat.
Ferdinand Bongbong Marcos Jr., officially the 17th President of the Philippine Republic. Following his inauguration rites at the National Museum, Marcos met with foreign dignitaries who attended his inauguration.
A toast to you all, to our partners, our friends around the world, who have done us the honor of coming and join us to commemorate this extremely important day. And to thank you for the partnership and the hands of partnership that you have offered, and to toast to the strengthening of our continuing relationships between the Philippines and your country.
Shortly after, Marcos headed to Malacañang with his wife and children. There, he received arrival honors and led the oath-taking of his cabinet members. Marcos's return to Malacañang is historic on its own. 36 years ago, the Marcos family fled the palace for Hawaii after the fall of the Marcos dictatorship.
President Marcos's inaugural speech was centered on hope for a better future. He vowed to bring the country back to its glory days, which he says was achieved during his late father's rule. Take a look.
Ako, si Ferdinand Romualdez Marcos Jr. ay taimtim na nanunumpa. Natutuparin ko na buong katapatan at sigasig ang aking mga tungkulin bilang Pangulo ng Pilipinas.
President Ferdinand Marcos Jr. began his inaugural speech by saying his electoral victory was the people's way of rejecting what he calls the politics of division.
By your vote, you rejected the politics of division. I offended none of my rivals in this campaign. I listened instead to what they were saying, and I saw little incompatibility with my own ideas about jobs, fair wages, personal safety, and national strength, and ending want in a land of plenty. I believe that if we but focus on the work at hand and the work that will come to hand, we will go very far under my watch. I did not talk much in this campaign. I did not bother to think of rebutting my rivals. Instead, I searched for promising approaches better than the usual solutions. I listened to you.
Marcos says he's ready for the task of leading the country in its recovery from this pandemic. He's urging the public to forget the past and just look ahead to a better future.
The changes we seek will benefit all and will shortchange no one. I was not the instrument of change. You were that. You made it happen. I am here not to talk about the past. I am here to tell you about our future. A future of sufficiency, even plenty, of readily available ways and means to get done what needs doing, by you, by me. We do not look back, but ahead, up the road that we must take to a place better than the one we lost in the pandemic. Gains made and lost, opportunities missed, well-laid plans superseded by the pandemic. Indeed, ours was the fastest growing economy in ASEAN. These are troubling times. What's happening to others can happen to us, but it will not. We see what's happening. We are witness to how it is being stopped. and we have seen the glory that crowns struggle against all odds. Giving up is not an option.
Aside from the pandemic, the president also addressed issues hounding the country, including food self-sufficiency and the effects of Russia's invasion of Ukraine.
We are presently drawing up a comprehensive, all-inclusive plan for economic transformation. We will build back better by doing things in the light of the experiences that we have had, both good and bad. It doesn't matter. No looking back in anger or nostalgia. In the road ahead, the immediate months will be rough, but I will walk that road with you.
Marcos also made several mentions of his father's rule, claiming the country prospered under the late dictator, Ferdinand Marcos Sr.
I once knew a man who saw what little had been achieved since independence in a land of people with the greatest potential for achievement, and yet they were poor. But he got it done, sometimes with the needed support, sometimes without. So will it be with his son. You will get no excuses from me. The role of agriculture cries for the urgent attention that its neglect and misdirection now demands. Food self-sufficiency has been the key promise of every administration. None but one delivered.
From his delivery to the content, here are some of the reactions to President Marcos's inaugural address.
I listen to you.
One of the aspects of President Marcos's speech that caught analysts by surprise is the choice of language. Sociologist Ash Presto had expected Marcos to deliver his speech in Filipino to directly address the lower to middle classes who voted for him.
I was actually a bit expecting of President Marcos to deliver his speech in Filipino. You would expect someone who won majority of the votes and who actually adopts the branding that he is the president of the lower and the middle class, and you would expect him to deliver this speech in Filipino just like what former president Joseph Estrada did.
But for historian Manolo Quezon, the choice of the English language has something to do with evoking authority.
Carlos P. Romulo once said that the one thing that Filipinos expect of a president is someone who will make decisions for them. If you look at the heart of this speech, it was that assurance. It's a very traditional assurance, a very top-down assurance, and therefore delivered in the language of authority, which is English. That is the reason. It is a middle-class speech. It is a speech that said, government will get out of your way, which is the number one desire of the middle class throughout the world. It is not a speech for the mass.
Quezon also noting how different Marcos's manner of delivery is from former President Rodrigo Duterte's.
We are no longer used to hearing speeches properly written and properly delivered. So that was the first thing that I think took everyone by surprise.
Carlos Conde, Asia Senior Researcher of Human Rights Watch, is disappointed that Marcos made no mention of some of the most pressing issues hounding the Filipino people.
This might be, you know, ironic to expect of a president like Mr. Marcos for him to say some things about, you know, social justice, human rights, press freedom. But these are real issues in the Philippines. For him to leave out any mention of those, even just a short shrift, even just, you know, to acknowledge that these problems existed and persisted, would have made a little difference.
Food inflation is one of the most pressing problems that needs the attention of President Marcos. Nomura's senior ASEAN economist, Yuben Parasuela, says in terms of rising prices of commodities, the Philippines is one of the most vulnerable in Asia.
At Nomura, we've been worried about food inflation for a while, but I think the way things have panned out in the last few months, I think things are really getting even scarier than we first thought. That requires urgent attention, requires a lot of policies immediately, not just from the central bank, but more importantly, actually from the new government.
Parasvales also says the Marcos administration may be forced to make the unpopular move of possibly raising taxes to boost government revenues. Calixto Chiquiamco of the Foundation for Economic Freedom believes fixing the failures of the outgoing administration should also be high on Marcos's to-do list.
The Duterte administration has achieved a lot of economic reforms, but I think on three areas they have failed. One is, of course, on agriculture. Second is energy security. Right now, we're seeing very thin reserves and, in fact, intermittent brownouts. And third, of course, is really the fiscal challenge now with PPP, the Duterte administration stopped PPP. Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm. So I think on those three fronts, the economic team will be very busy.
President Marcos wants to improve the Philippines' image as a solid economic destination. But international investment banker Stephen Kunying notes macro fundamentals are not the only thing businesses will consider when they decide to invest in the country.
I think the economic attractiveness and all that stuff, that's valuation driven, that's pricing driven. What does everybody, citizens, investors, observers, look for? One, rule of law. Is this going to be an improvement, a move backwards, status quo? Because you want rules to be not just stable, they can change, but followed. Second, peace and stability. Before you start thinking of whether to invest and what price, you think, is it worth investing? And what starts with that is peace and stability. So is that going to be maintained?
The Philippine press may need to double its efforts under the next administration. Veteran journalist Melinda Quintos de Jesus says the media will have to do so much more, especially if the government steps up its efforts to silence dissent.
I think there's a challenge, and the challenge is bigger than what we may be ready to actually address. The landscape has changed immensely, and if the government adds to it the weight of its force in terms of trying to silence criticism and dissenting voices, then we are definitely going to be called on to do something much more than what we have been doing so far. We need to get out where they are. Where is it? We need to get the news out there in all the different digital platforms where the people are already. We will have to reinvent the ways in which to make news more brief, more direct, more speaking their own vernacular language, the different styles in which they take on, the visualization of data.
Now, several members of Marcos's cabinet and other appointed officials also sworn in Thursday. Among those present in the oath-taking were his Education Secretary, Vice President Sara Duterte, Social Welfare Chief Erwin Tulfo, and Executive Secretary Vic Rodriguez. Contrary to expectations, Tulfo said there will be no cabinet meeting today. In an interview here on ANC, Tulfo also admitted there's a lot of work to be done to address issues within the Social Welfare Department. The broadcast journalist added the media will play a big role in fixing these issues, as he encouraged reporters to call out potential anomalies. Tulfo also wants to digitalize the distribution of aid.
I already ordered my staff starting tomorrow to review these long lines. Every time or whenever you go to the DSWD office, there's a long line of people. Kasi the bureaucracy and the red tape, yung fill out pa lang ng forms, may mga questions doon na shouldn't be asked anymore. Yan din po ang marching order sa akin ng Pangulo, na wag na pong pahirapan yung mga mahihirap. Kaya nga po, ang pinaka-solution po dyan is to digitalize lahat po ng DSWD offices.
Incoming National Economic and Development Authority Chief Arsenio Balisacan admits economic challenges brought by the pandemic and international conflicts are enormous. Balisacan, however, believes the Philippines can weather through these hurdles. In the meantime, he wants the incoming administration to address issues weighing down the agriculture sector.
We hope that this time we are able to address with finality the illnesses of our agricultural sector, and that illnesses to is seen in terms of the very low productivity, very low profitability, of the very inefficiency in agriculture, the pathetic performance over the years has impacted a lot on our ability to reduce poverty in particular, because the bulk of the large majority of our poor people are dependent on agriculture and agriculture-related activities.
President Marcos has yet to name his pick to head one of the most crucial government agencies, the Health Department. For his thoughts on who should be the next DOH chief, we have with us former Health Secretary Manuel Dayrit. Dr. Dayrit, thank you for joining us.
Good afternoon, Denise, and good afternoon to everyone.
Dr. Dayrit, a lot of health groups and even the former health secretary have already mentioned the recommendations or even the qualities that the next health secretary should have. What about for you?
Denise, the job of a health secretary is really immense. We're looking for a health leader, a person with a mission for healthcare for all Filipinos. And therefore, you know, you're looking for a technocrat and manager with very good political skills. That's the type of person that you're looking for.
Do you see those qualities in a specific person, sir?
Well, you know, I can't mention any specific person, but if we were to dissect those competencies, first of all, the health secretary has to work with the president, the cabinet, the legislature, local governments. So that person must have very good political skills, working within the health sector and beyond, across sectors. So that's one. But also, the health secretary has to have very good management savvy, you know, a strategic thinker and organizer. Because the health secretary manages the public health bureaucracy and manages the budget. Okay, so governance in the public sector is very important. And then third, the health secretary has to have really technical savvy, meaning to say the health secretary has to understand the technicalities involved in improving access and affordability and the financing of public health services, medicines, preventing and responding to epidemics. So those are the competencies: political, managerial, and technical. This is the type of person that you're looking for, a person with those competencies.
Now, it is the inauguration, and until now, there is still no word on who will be the incoming health secretary. Do you think the late appointment, late announcement, will have a big impact on the transitioning, even if the current DOH department has already said that they've already, ironed out all the details and are just ready to present it to the next health secretary?
I don't really know the reason for the delay, Denise, no? But I'm thinking that because we're still in the pandemic, they're very careful to choose the right person. But of course, there's a delay, you know? And coming into the first day of the administration, you know, you're thinking about your short-term goals. And one of the short-term goals, really, of the next administration is how to consolidate the learnings of the pandemic, because there were a lot of learnings in the pandemic and you don't want to lose them. And so you have to organize the bureaucracy to consolidate those learnings, learn from them, and institutionalize them, you know, for future pandemics.
How heavy, Dr. Dayrit, is the burden and the work laid out for the incoming health secretary, knowing of all the issues that have hounded the department throughout this pandemic, even with the formerly issue and also the distrust of the public with the agency?
I think in fairness to the past administration, we can say that they've actually laid down the policy framework for moving forward. And that policy framework is really the universal healthcare law. And therefore, the Department of Health is focused on its implementation. But it's very, very difficult, huh? Because these are new arrangements that have to do with local governments, financing, and so on and so forth. So that's a very, very crucial issue that has to be addressed. But beyond the short term, really the issue has to do with modernizing the public health system. Because our public health system is very, very antiquated. And over the medium term, you have to renovate and improve, you know, in a vast way, your rural health units, your district hospitals, and get them to work coherently and cohesively. You just can't do patchwork work here. You'd really have to design a modernization program for the public health system.
So, Dr. Dorit, would you say that the incoming health secretary would have more to change or to improve from the current groundwork that the past administration has built on, or I guess just build on what the past administration has already set for them?
I think the new secretary has to walk on two legs. The first leg is implementing the policy framework that already was established by the previous administration. Okay, very good implementation is critical. But the other is really the issue of modernizing the system, even as you're implementing your current imperatives. Okay, and modernizing the system means, you know, allocating your budgets, you know, finding new ways and new arrangements, working with the private sector. All of that has to come into play. And of course, working across with all of the sectors in government, because health is really not just within one sector. You have to involve all of the other sectors to improve health in the country.
Former Health Secretary Dr. Manuel Dayrit. Dr. Dayrit, thank you so much for your time.
Thank you, Denise, and good afternoon.
More news. Former Philippine President Rodrigo Duterte set to get a warm welcome in his hometown as he starts his life as a private citizen. His supporters organized a homecoming concert in Davao del Sur. Some local artists are expected to perform at the event later today. Meanwhile, before departing Malacañang, Duterte met with members of his cabinet for the last time. He thanked his secretaries for helping him serve the country. Duterte also reiterated his call for Filipinos to support the Philippines' next set of leaders.
Let us give all our support to the new administration. Tulungan natin sila. Tulungan natin sila.
The founder of Go Negosyo says one of the most notable aspects of the outgoing administration is its push to help micro, small, and medium enterprises. Joey Concepcion, who's also the presidential advisor for entrepreneurship, says President Duterte always made sure MSMEs had the support they need, especially when the pandemic hit.
One very important thing is his attention to MSMEs. No, in most of our events, he was there. No, he tried to be there in most of the events. You can see the support of what he has given the Department of Trade and Industry, which is basically the center point of MSME development. No, and DTI coordinates with the different government agencies. So it was a concerted action, again, another public-private partnership between Go Negosyo and DTI and the Department of Agriculture, with launching various initiatives, especially our mentoring program, which is critical in helping our MSMEs. No? And we saw more funding given to our MSMEs, especially in the time of the pandemic. They were supported not only through mentorship, but to refinancing their obligations, which hit them really hard during these lockdowns.
Up next, Filipino activists in North America protest the presidency of Ferdinand Marcos Jr.
And former Philippine House lawmaker Rolando Andaya Jr. has passed away. More news when we return.
Now, before we let you enjoy your life as a private citizen, we still want to hear your thoughts and wisdom as a veteran lawmaker and politician. First, before we talk about Congress, we want to hear your appraisal of President Marcos's inaugural speech, his call for unity, as well as his mention of moving forward and not dwelling on the past.
Well, the way I've premised his overall speech, it seems that he has practically studied the situation of the country in the last 3 or 4 years. I was expecting something like that, and I did hear it from him.
Okay, now as much as he wants to hit the ground running, there's also one issue there. There are still vacancies in critical posts in his cabinet, specifically the health, the energy, and the foreign affairs departments. What do you make of that?
Well, it's better to be cautious in those very controversial and very important departments. Like, for example, in the Department of Foreign Affairs, you know, it's very difficult to fill in the shoes of Secretary Teddy Boy Loxin, who was very successful in his stint. No, so I will not be surprised if he is asked to stay. But nevertheless, it's of course it's all in the decision of the president. What I sense is that the controversial ones is very cautious. As a matter of fact, in the Department of Agriculture, he has assigned himself
right
to at the helm at this point. Now, health and energy, you know what's going on. You know the controversy with the Department of Health, and considering the pandemic is not really gone. Also the Department of Energy, I think, is trying to make sure that the person he would be appointing would really fit the department and would know what to do, especially with the controversial moves of the former secretary. What's his name again?
Secretary Dar?
The energy secretary.
Oh, the energy secretary. Alfonso Cusi.
Yeah, Cusi. Yeah, Secretary Cusi. He was Al Cusi. Yes, I think there were very controversial moves that were done by the department in the last few months, as a matter of fact.
What controversial moves are those, sir? You're talking about the Malampaya deal?
The Malampaya deals and the supposed to be joint explorations that should have been done years ago. Should have been started years ago.
Okay, let's now talk about the upper chamber. What do you think will be the greatest challenge for the incoming Senate and the next Senate President, Senator Mig Zubiri?
Well, Senator Zubiri has a very good background already on how to handle the Senate because he's been majority leader a number of times, a couple of times, I do remember. And he has been well versed with the goings on of the Senate. Now, as far as the legislative work is concerned, I think they will have to rely very much in the proposed legislative agenda of the new administration, because the previous administration had its legislative priorities, and as much as well. More or less, we were able to pass more than 50% of those priorities. But again, the pandemic was a different situation, so we had to adapt. But now that more or less we're in the clear, although I think there are new cases coming up, although we are somewhat in the clear, I think the Department of Health and the legislative priorities of the executive department would play a very important role on how the Senate legislative work will go on. I can the best suggestion I could make is for them to have a very active let-up. The Legislative Executive Development Advisory Council. It was very silent. We had a few let-up meetings with the Legislative Executive Department in the first year or two of the Senate President Duterte. But then afterwards, in the last, even before the pandemic, there was no let-up meetings. We had a one or two mini let-up meetings, but that sufficed. I think the new administration must have at least a let-up meeting every month to be able to more or less gauge on the priorities or whether the priorities are being done or not.
So are you saying, sir, that they have to wait for the executive before they can come up with their own priorities at the Senate?
Yeah, usually. That's what is usually done. Mm-hmm. Although, the 1st of July, by tomorrow, I will not be surprised if many of the senators, I don't know about the House of Representatives, but in the Senate, they will be filing their bills already.
Right.
Now, the bills that they are filing, some of them would be refiles. Some of them would be the former senators' bills. And those will have been included in the legislative agenda of the former executive department. But then again, they don't work until July 25.
Right.
They don't really convene until July 25 to be able to refer the different bills into the different committees. Because by July 26, that is the only time they will be electing their committee chairman, so committee chairperson. So that will be enough time for them to meet with the legislative, the executive department, and hopefully by August, more or less, we will have a pretty good picture of how the legislative agenda of Senate of President Marcos would be.
Mr. Senator, of the bills that did not make it during your time, are there any particular ones that you would hope to be refiled this time around?
Well, in my case, not really. Nothing comes to mind at this point because the last important bill that I filed was passed by both houses, and it is in the office of the president now for its signature. President Marcos may sign it. It's the it's my bill creating a separate facilities for heinous criminals, including high level drug traffickers.
In your farewell speech at the Senate, you made a call for the body to maintain the integrity and the independence of the upper chamber. Did you make that statement? Did you make that call because of the supermajority at the Senate and that there may be a possibility that they would just become a rubber stamp of the president? Are you confident also that the incoming Senate President Mig Zubiri won't allow that to happen?
Well, whether a supermajority or a simple majority, the important thing is that through the years we have been able to preserve the independence of the Senate. My suggestion or my advice was that they should remain critical if necessary, but they should also be cooperative, and that is the way the Senate has been run. I've worked with 9 Senate presidents, and I've seen the best. And that is how the Senate retains its integrity, by being cooperative but critical if necessary.
Finally, sir, we saw you doing your last role as Senate president earlier this morning. That's the reading of the joint resolution proclaiming Ferdinand Marcos as the winner of the last elections. You said before that it was either a higher office for you or retirement. Now, your reading of the joint resolution, is that really it? Is that really going to be your last act as a public servant ever?
Most probably. At this point, that's how I look at it. As I told President Marcos earlier, I said that was my final assignment. And he said, mission accomplished. But he... he has told me one time or another that we should talk again. I said, if probably in the next 2 or 3 years my help is needed, maybe if I'm still around. Of course, I said that in jest. I am going to reactivate our Citizens Drug Watch. It's an NGO, and that can really help government being also even if we're in the private sector. The Citizens Drug Watch used to be chaired by Senator Boy Herrera, and I was the vice chairman. When he died, that was also the time that I became minority leader, majority leader, eventually Senate president. So I was able to reactivate it. So now I'm reactivating it, and I had a chance to talk to Vice President Sara earlier, and she's willing to be the honorary chairman. Mm. I can chair the Drug Watch, and it would be an encompassing nationwide group, citizens against illegal drugs. And it would be working hand-in-hand with her preventive education program, which is part of what the Citizens Drug Watch wants to do.
That's very interesting, sir. Maybe we can have another chance to talk to you more about that in our future discussions. Former Senate President Tito Soto, thank you very much, sir.
Thank you, Ron.
Okay. On to more news. Hundreds of Filipino-American activists gathered in front of the Philippine Consulate in Los Angeles to stage a protest against the presidency of Bongbong Marcos. Steve Angeles with the details.
About 100 Filipino-American activists gathered at the consulate in protest to reject the incoming administration, whom they've labeled as dynasties, that Filipinos in the Philippines as well as overseas have struggled under.
Sinusuka natin ang panunumbalik ng pamilyang Marcos sa Malacanang at ang pagpapatuloy ng pamamuno ng mga Duterte sa Pilipinas. Ito ang dalawang dinastiya, Marcos at Duterte, na nagpahirap sa mamamayang Pilipino ng ilang dekada at ilang taon.
From human rights advocates to victims of martial law, Filipino-Americans sounded the alarm on the first day of Bongbong Marcos' presidency, expressing their concerns.
We're all here today to reject the Marcos and Duterte administration that is upcoming today with the inauguration. It's very significant that we be here today, as we know that the election was based off of a lot of disinformation and vote buying and cheating. And we also just recognize that there is a lot of violence and repression during the time of martial law with Marcos Sr.
For those that had lived through martial law, they warned that another martial law may be on the horizon, while the political killings under the past President Rodrigo Duterte could continue.
We are really concerned of the new Marcos Duterte presidency in continuing the fascist legacy of their fathers, right? Marcos Sr., who we have seen the atrocities of his a fascist dictatorship across amongst the people, as well as President Rodrigo Duterte, where we have seen in the past 4 years over 30,000 extrajudicial killings, the pork barreling of money or the stealing of money from the masses. And we already see the tyranny and the abuse of power that the current new Marcos and Duterte presidency is already enacting on the people.
These activists add that even before the administration was sworn in, they were already concerned over the SEC ruling to shut down news media site Rappler.
As far as the president's Southern California-based supporters, many of them actually went to the Philippines to partake in the inauguration festivities. However, they are planning a local event next month with the Ilocos Norte governor, Matthew Manotto, the president's nephew. Activists here are planning to crash that event.
Former Philippine House lawmaker Rolando Andaya Jr. has passed away. His children said Andaya died this morning, though they did not specify the cause of his death. The former Camarines Sur representative ran but lost in the province's gubernatorial race in the 2022 elections. More to come, the World Health Organization calling for an intensified global response against monkeypox.
And France sentences the main suspect in the 2015 Paris attacks to life in jail. Stay with us.
Thanks for watching Top Story. Philippine shares see a big sell down on the day of Bongbong Marcos's inauguration. The main index shed over 2% or some 147 points to close at 61.55. Value turnover was at 6.4 billion pesos. Analysts attributed the decline to persistent worries over a possible recession as several central banks continue their aggressive monetary tightening.
The World Health Organization sees the emergency nature of monkeypox. WHO Director General Tedros Ghebreyesus says while they have not declared monkeypox as a public health emergency of international concern, they admit there is a need for an intensified response. The WHO chief notes the countermeasures will be similar to handling the pandemic, which includes equitable access to vaccines and antiviral treatments. At least 50 nations have been affected by the monkeypox outbreak. Many of them are in Europe.
Overseas, the chief suspect in the 2015 Paris attacks gets a life sentence. Salah Abdeslam was found guilty Wednesday for killing 130 people in the French capital, November of 2015. Police captured a 32-year-old 4 months after the bloodbath in Paris. The Islamic State had claimed the attacks. Abdeslam's trial, that wrapped up 6 years of investigation, is seen as the biggest in modern French history. 19 other suspects involved in the attacks were also given 2 years to up to a lifetime in jail.
Switching gears now, Natalie Portman celebrates female strength as she stars in Thor, Love and Thunder. Yong Chavez tells us more about some of the characters in the latest Marvel film to hit the big screen.
As an actress, Oscar winner Natalie Portman relishes the chance to transform and play various characters. For Thor: Love and Thunder, her physical preparations began months before the cameras rolled so she could return to the Marvel film franchise as Jane Foster, now also known as the Mighty Thor.
It's so exciting to get to play a character like Jane. I feel so lucky to get to be, get to be a superhero. That's like such an extraordinary opportunity, and I feel so lucky to have had the chance. And Jane is also such an incredible character as an astrophysicist. I feel like that's exciting too, to get to represent to girls.
Her co-star Tessa Thompson celebrated Portman's and the Thor's cast's return on the big screen. Thompson also shared what it meant for her to be part of a big Hollywood film.
Natalie rejoining us, she's a good friend of mine, so having her felt like summer camp. The last time around, they were a little more freewheeling. This time, they're like, Thor is having a midlife crisis. Valkyrie has finally turned herself around and is a woman of bureaucracy and responsibility. And so it's fun to play these characters that we love so much and see them grow as we grow too. I grew up in Los Angeles. I used to come to movies here. My dad would take me to this cinema, and it was always like a big deal when I got to see movies here. So I can't believe I am now in movies here.
The film recently held its star-studded world premiere in Hollywood, led by Thor himself, Chris Hemsworth. The latest Marvel movie also stars film actor Dave Bautista, who appears as his Guardians of the Galaxy character, Drax.
Thor: Love and Thunder is directed by Taika Waititi, who also returns in the movie as Korg. Yong Chavez, ABS-CBN News, here in Hollywood.
And those were the top stories today. I'm Denise Dinsai.
And I'm Ron Cruz. You can watch exclusive content and highlights and recaps of our shows online. Thank you for watching.
Methods, no? And we have allowed more transportation to come out. That's